gotta keep my integrity. I gotta walk like a man. You better speak up when you talk to me. You better lift up your chin. I'm about to take over the globe. I got the whole world in my hand. I've been here before, that's the reason he sent me to do it all over again. I gotta keep my integrity. I gotta walk like a man. You better speak up when you talk to me. You better lift up your chin. I'm about to take over the globe. I got the whole world in my hand. I've been here before, that's the reason he sent me to do it all over again. Can't take you serious, you acting petty, making me laugh like Ed, Ed, and Eddie. Run out of truth when things are too heavy, like Kevin Hart, he wasn't ready. I take a bullet, I die for my people. You pull the trigger just to get equal. Most of you people fall out cause it's hard. Take pressure like Job, I'm on my job. I can't believe it, in spiritual Egypt, my people are evil than ever before. They kill a nigga with chicken like damn, bruh, I can't even walk to the store. They be out here screaming, Jesus, I love you. When I know that.
All right, so today's class, before headquarters come on, is going to be called What the Health. The title for today's class is What the Health. Now, I know many of y'all saw that Netflix documentary. It was called What the Health. And you saw that thing and you was like, oh, Lord, I'm going to be a raw vegan the rest of my life. A month later, you had fallen short of the glory of God. We just gonna say that. But today's class is gonna be What the Health. This is good for us to go over this, to re-examine ourselves in this walk, in this truth. Give me Ezra chapter 9. Let's read 7-9. Make sure you got your pen, paper, Bible, and apocryphas so you can take some notes and learn. Let's read that.
Ezra chapter 9 and verse 7. Since the days of our fathers have we been in a great trespass unto this day, and for our iniquities have we, our kings and our priests, been delivered into the hand of the kings of the lands, to the sword, to captivity and to spoil, and to confusion of face, as it is this day.
As it was then, the same as it is now. We are under the hand of our oppressor. This captivity just happens to be Babylon the Great, a.k.a. America, which is the last one, according to the scriptures. Read on.
And now, for a little space, grace have been showed from the Lord our God, to leave us a remnant to escape, and to give us a nail in his holy place, that our God may lighten our eyes and give us a little reviving of our bondage.
Now understand that. Now in this little space, this little time that we have, because it is a little time, we have grace. We are in that grace moment. Read on.
For we were bondmen, yet our God hath not forsaken us in our bondage, but hath extended mercy unto us in the sight of the kings of Persia, to give us a reviving, to set up the house of our God, and to repair the desolations thereof, and to give us a wall in Judah and in Jerusalem.
So we are in that moment of grace, and that grace comes through Christ, just like our forefathers was in captivity, but they had a little bit of grace. We've got that same thing now. And we are today, with us being in the truth, knowing that we are Israelites, knowing that the Sabbath is the seventh day, right? We are living proof that God has not forsaken us in the last days. We are living proof of that, right? Go to Acts 2:16 to show you. We are living proof that God has not forsaken us in our captivity and has extended his grace through his Son onto us.
Acts.
Read that.
Acts chapter 2 and verse 16. Yep. But this is the which was spoken by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your younger men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams.
Now, real quick, to know what the last days are, right? Go to the book of Hebrews chapter 1 so you can precept this together. What is the last days? How do we know? We've been hearing of these things forever. Hebrews chapter 1 and if you got it, yep.
Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 2. hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things.
Heir
of all things, by whom also he made the world.
So when Christ gave his life on that cross and was resurrected into the heavens and sat on the right hand of God, that began the last days. That began the beginning of sorrows that we are in. And according to the scriptures, it's truly only been 2 days and three, going into 3 days now. It's 3 days that we've been in there. So we living out the prophecies of those last days to come. Going back to Acts chapter 2, read verse 17 again.
Acts chapter 2 and verse 17. And that shall come to pass in the last days, saith God. I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your younger men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaids I will pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy.
Give me that in Revelation 19 to show how we all prophesy. We don't want to get it confused like many people have where... You know, see, women, we can prophesy. Acts 2 is the proof of it. That's not what it's talking about. Let's go to Revelation 19. Let's start at verse 9. Let's read 9 and 10.
Revelation chapter 19 and verse 9. And he saith unto me, write, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he saith unto me, these are the true sayings of God. And I fell at his feet to worship him. And he said unto me, see thou, do it not. I am thy fellow servant and of thy brethren that have the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy.
So that's how we all prophesy. The testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. So what do we men do with that testimony of the Lord? Our job is to take that testimony of the Lord and take it out into the highways and byways, to call the people in, to compel them to come in. That's our job as a man. What is the sister's job when it is coming to prophesying? Their job is through their speech and through their actions to show the glory of God, the glory of Jesus, what has happened to them, how his life has changed their life through their actions and their speech of speaking about him. Let's prove it. Let's go to 1 John chapter 5. Verse 9, and let's read 9 through 12 about what is that testimony of Christ that should be spoken of.
1 John chapter 5 and verse 9. If we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater. For this is the witness of God, which he hath testified of his Son. He that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself. Mm-hmm. He that believeth not God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave of his Son.
Remember that word, record. Read on.
And this is the record that God have given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that have the Son have life, and he that have not the Son of God have not life.
Have not life. Now let's get into that record and show you what it really means. Pull up the definition that was in the groups. Pull up the definition of record. Okay, so let's read that. Let's see what it say.
The definition of record: to set down in writing, furnish written evidence of, to deposit an authentic official copy of.
All right, let's scroll down. What's that? B says what? To state
for, or as if for the record.
Uh-huh. Let's go down. So let's go down to, look, number 2 says to give evidence of.
To cause sound, visual images, data, etc. to be registered on something, such as a disc or magnetic tape.
Our sound and visual images and data has been registered in the Bible in reproducible form. The Bible's reproduced over. It's printed out. It's the number one selling book on the earth, right? Let's go down to synonyms of it. Keep going, because it's a lot of different definitions of record. Go back in the same.
Synonyms for record.
Okay.
Or for record. Account, chronicle, chronological, commentary, usual commentaries, history, narration, narrative, report, story.
Okay, so those are synonyms of it. Now go to the next one, the thesaurus, to show. Thesaurus. It should already be in it. I posted everything. Thesaurus. We want to pull it up. Y'all told me y'all had it back there this Sabbath. Y'all told me y'all was good to go. They said it was. Yeah, I'm looking at it. They said they was ready to go. All right, so this is the thesaurus, right? Read the synonyms for thesaurus. That's not, that is. Go up. Okay, right there. Let's see. Read that. Words related to record, record. Read it.
Versions. Deposition, documentation, testament.
Testament.
Testimonial.
Testimonial.
Testimony.
Testimony. Testimony. That's another way of saying record. Now let's go back to the scripts. 1 John chapter 5.
1 John chapter 5.
Let's read verse 10.
Verse 10.
Through 12 again to get the understanding. Now we know record is another way of saying testimony. Read that.
He that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself. He that believeth not God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave of his Son.
The testimony. And what is that? Read.
And this is the record that God hath given to us eternal life. And this life is in his Son.
Uh-huh.
He that hath the Son hath life. And he that hath not the Son of God have not life.
So the testimony of Christ is that through him and the keeping of the commandments, you receive eternal life. That's how you prophesy of Christ. That's why it's our job as man to go out on the street, teach the people, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Come in, keep the commandments. Through Christ, you have eternal life. And you sisters, are in your actions and your speech, when you speak to people, you let them know. If you repent and keep the commandments and the faith in Christ, you will have eternal life. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 16. So that's the testimony of Christ. That's how you prophesy, speak the spirit of prophecy of Christ. 1 Corinthians 3, 16 and 17.
1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 16.
Uh-huh.
Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you?
So understand that we all the temple of God. The Spirit dwells in us, right? Now go to the picture. Go to the picture that we had put up. All of us are the temple of God. Now, this is one thing that we read that, but we don't actually understand what that temple represented or what it looked like, what all went into that temple. Zoom in on it some. I want you to zoom in on it so we can actually see what the scripts are talking about. Now, we know this is a replica, so it was even more beautiful than this. Scroll down so we can see the main part. Now just leave that up there. Leave that part right there, and let's go to 1 Kings chapter 6. Leave the visual, and let's read the script so we can get somewhat of a visual of what that temple looked like on the inside. 1 Kings chapter 6, we're going to read verse 1, and then we'll jump.
1 Kings chapter 6 and verse 1. And it came to pass in the 480th year of the children of Israel were come out of the land of Egypt, in the fourth year of Solomon's reign over Israel, in the month Ziph, which is the second month, that he began to build the house of the Lord.
That he began to build the house of the Lord, right? Now jump down to verse 11.
Verse 11. And the word of the Lord came to Solomon, saying, concerning this house which thou art in building, if thou wilt walk in my statutes and execute my judgments and keep all my commandments to walk in them, Then will I perform my word with thee, which I spake unto David my father.
Read on.
And I will dwell among the children of Israel, and will not forsake my people Israel. So Solomon built the house.
The house or the temple. Read.
And finished it.
Jump down to verse 21, and let's read through 30 to see what the house looked like when it was finished. Read that.
Verse 21. So Solomon overlaid the house within the pure gold.
Hold on. Read it. You got to read it right, man.
So Solomon overlaid the house within with pure gold.
So the whole house was full of gold. Full of gold, y'all. Everything. Read on.
And he made a partition by the chains of gold before the oracle. And he overlaid it with gold. And the whole house he overlaid with gold. Until he had finished all the house. Also, the whole altar that was by the oracle, he overlaid with gold.
With gold. As you can see, if you look right there where the priest is in the blue, that altar in front of him, all gold. Read on.
And within the oracle, he made two cherubims of olive tree, each 10 cubits high. And 5 cubits was the one wing of the cherub, and 5 cubits the other wing of the cherub. For the uttermost part of the one wing unto the uttermost part of the other were 10 cubits.
Uh-huh.
And the other cherub was 10 cubits. Both the cherubims were of one measure and one size.
Now, I looked it up, what they say a cubit, the measurement of it during biblical times, during this time, they said it was 18 inches. Okay. So that means that. The 10
verse 26, the height
26, there we go, the 10 cubits, right? The 10 cubits would have measured out to be I think it was 15 or 20 feet. It was either five or 10 feet, one of the two, and that's the wingspan of it. The wingspan of it was 10 feet long, right? Read that again.
Verse 26. The height of the other one cherub.
Check that for me on Google back there. Cubits into inches.
The height of the other one cherub was 10 cubits. And so was it of the other cherub.
Read on.
And he set the cherubims within the inner house. And they stretched forth the wings of the cherubims. So that the wing of the one touched the one wall, and the wing of the other cherub touched the other wall, and their wings touched one another in the midst of the house. And he overlaid the cherubims with gold.
Oh, okay. 10 cubits. I'm looking at it here. 10 cubits is 20 feet. Yeah, I got it right here. 10 cubits is 20 feet long. So the one wing was 10 cubits, 20 feet long. So these is big wings. These is big images painted on or carved into the walls, overlaid with pure gold. 20-foot long wings. All right, go ahead, pick up.
Verse 29. And he carved all the walls of the house round about with carved figures of cherubims and palm trees and open flowers within and without.
Uh-huh.
And the floor of the house he overlaid with gold.
So we looking at it right here. The whole floor, as soon as you walked in the temple, was gold. Now, understand, that wasn't no dusty gold. That was the most precious gold of Ophir. So you can look down in that thing and see yourself. You can see your reflection. The manure is all around. Everything overlaid with gold. So if you open the doors and the sun hit it just right, it might blind you. It was perfection inside that temple. All right? All right, let's go back to the script. First Corinthians 3 and 16, just so we can get a visual of what God's talking about when he says with that temple. Read that.
First Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 16. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God?
We are that temple. We are that beautiful temple overlaid with gold on the inside. Go ahead.
And that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you.
Uh-huh.
If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy. For the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are.
Now, there's many different ways to defile a temple, right? And especially defile our temple. The first and foremost is sin. Let's get that in Mark chapter 7. The first and foremost way to defile our temple is sin. Mark chapter 7, let's start at verse 14 through 23.
Mark chapter 7 and verse 14. Because straight is the gate. Sorry.
Mark 7, verse 14 through 23.
Mark chapter 7 and verse 14.
Uh-huh.
And when he had called all the people unto him, he said unto them, hearken unto me, every one of you, and understand, there is nothing from without a man that entering into him can defile him, but the things which come out of him, those are they that defile
him. Now, before we go any further, for somebody turn off the video or your power go out or something, I want you to understand that the Christ is not telling you that unclean foods don't defile you. He's not talking about that at all. Let's go to first, before we go back to the law, let's get Matthew 5:17. That's precepting. 5:17 and 18.
Matthew chapter 5 and verse 17. Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law.
That's the words of Christ, that no law shall pass, right? So let's go to Leviticus chapter 11, and let's read 46 and 47.
Leviticus chapter 11, verse 46.
Remember today's class, what the health?
This is the law of the beast and of the fowl and of every living creature that moveth in the waters and of every creature that creepeth upon the earth to make a difference between the unclean and the clean and between the beast that may be eaten and the beast that may not be eaten.
See, Christ didn't come to fulfill the law where you can now eat cat, rat, dog, and whatever you want to and sprinkle some sauce on it and make it taste good. He didn't come to do away the law so you can eat some alligator. He didn't come to do away the law so you can eat chitlins, pork chops, shrimp, crap. He did not come to do away with that law. That law still stands, that there are certain things that may be eaten and certain things that may not be eaten. Understanding that we are the temple. Jump back up to verse 44.
Verse 44, for I am the Lord your God. Ye shall therefore sanctify yourselves, and ye shall be holy, for I am holy. Neither shall ye defile yourselves.
Defile your what?
Defile yourselves.
You shall not defile your temple. By what way?
With any manner of creepy thing that creepeth upon the earth.
So unclean foods can defile your temple, which goes into being sin. Let's go back to that mark now. Now we got the understanding. Christ ain't talking about unclean foods don't defile you. No, because the law said unclean foods will defile you. And that was just talking about creepy things. But you read up in the chapter, it goes into a whole list of other things it talks about defiling you. Right? So Christ ain't talking to people about you can start eating whatever you want to from this moment on. He's not talking about that. Let's see what he's talking about. Let's read that verse 15 again.
Mark chapter 7, verse 15. There is nothing from without a man that entering into him can defile him, but the things which come out of him, those are they that defile the man.
So there is no clean food that a man will eat that can defile him. Read on.
If any man have ears to hear, let him hear. And when he was entered into the house from the people, his disciples asked him concerning the parable. And he saith unto them, are ye so without understanding also? Do ye not perceive that whatsoever thing from without entering into the man, it cannot defile him?
Read on.
Because it entereth not into his heart, but into the belly,
which is his mind. Go ahead.
And goeth out into the draught, purging all meats. And he said, that which cometh out of the man, that defileth the man.
That defiles a man. Remember, it said there's many different things that defiles a man. Sin is the main reason that defiles us. Read on.
For from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries,
sin,
fornications,
sin,
murders,
sin,
thefts,
sin,
covetousness,
sin,
wickedness,
sin,
deceit,
sin,
lasciviousness,
evil sexual desires, go ahead,
an evil eye,
hating your brother or your sister,
blasphemy, pride, foolishness, all these evil things come from within and defile the man.
So sin is the main thing that defiles us as a people, as the children of God. Sin is that main thing that can defile and destroy our temple. Let's go back to 1 Corinthians, and let's get verse 19 and 20. 1 Corinthians chapter 6 now. Let's read 19 and 20.
1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 19.
Uh-huh.
What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost?
Now you understood what that, you saw a glimpse of what the temple looked like. Paul's reminding us, don't you know that your body is that same temple? Now it's not in stones, but it's in flesh. Read on.
Which is in you? Check. Which is in you? Which ye have of God, and ye are not your own.
And we are not our own. So when it's coming to keeping the temple maintenance up, we don't have a say in what can be put into our body. You can't eat what you want to. You can't have bad health and be like, I'm going to die anyway. No, 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 no. That temple that is given to you by God is not yours. You have to keep it up to the standards of the person that gave it to you. Read on.
For ye are bought with a price.
Which was Christ's life, his blood. Go ahead.
Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's.
So we have to glorify God in our body, and a way of glorifying God through our body can be through our health. A lot of times we don't even think about that. We just say, oh, commandments. I got fringes on, head wrap, dress. I'm good. I glorify God. That's it. Thank you. I checked that off the box. But another way we can do that is through our health. We just got to be conscious of that thing. Go to Sirach chapter 30, and let's read 25. Let's read that, 25.
Sirach chapter 30 and verse 25.
We're going to jump. Go ahead.
A cheerful and good heart will have a care of his meat and diet.
Read that again.
A cheerful and good heart will have a care of his meat and diet.
Another way of saying that, a thankful to God that he woke me up in these last days and poured his spirit upon me when he did not have to. A thankful person will be conscious of the things that are in their body. They will be conscious of their diet. Read it again.
A cheerful and good heart will have a care of his meat and diet.
So a cheerful and good heart, somebody that has a good mind, that somebody that loves their self will have a care for what goes into their body. And here's why. Jump up to verse 21.
Verse 21. Give not over thy mind to heaviness, and afflict not thyself in thine own counsel.
That's going into depression. So a cheerful and a good heart will not let their own thoughts destroy their health. Read on.
The gladness of the heart is the life of man, and the joyfulness of a man prolongeth his days.
So it prolongs your days. Is that what I'm read on?
Love thine own soul and comfort thy heart. Remove sorrow far from thee, for sorrow have killed many, and there is no profit therein.
So that depression, when you don't have a cheerful and good mind, loving yourself, your diet is bad. It goes hand in hand. God just told you that it goes hand in hand. Don't matter. We don't worry about the experts. Say God been told us that when you in that state of mind, when you get trapped in your own thoughts, your diet is going to suffer. Therefore, your temple is going to slowly decay. Give me that first article of three food traps. Three food traps.
Three food traps to avoid when you are depressed.
Mm-hmm.
Learn how depression can affect your eating habits and what you can do to start making healthier choices.
Go ahead.
When you're struggling with depression, your eating habits often suffer.
See, it's the experts telling us what God Ben done said. All praises that in the last days he woke us up to see those things. And now we ain't got to trust in man. We can trust in God. God said a cheerful heart. You care for your diet. If you don't, it goes downhill. Go back to the article.
Some people overeat and gain weight, turning to food to lift their mood. Others find they're too exhausted to prepare balanced meals or that they've lost their appetite. Whether you're overeating or not eating enough, you may be using food to feel better or to cope with difficult feelings.
Now, that's very heavy. Now, amongst us in our nation, we find a lot of brothers and sisters are overweight, right? We see those things. Now, we've all lived hard lives. We've all lived hard lives and we use food to cope with it, right? Go back to the article. So you got to be mindful of those things.
Says Suzanne Albers, a clinical psychologist at the Cleveland Clinic in Worcester, Ohio, and the offer of 50 ways to soothe yourself without food. Albers tells WebMD that people often get trapped in a cycle of feeling trapped and hopeless about life and their poor eating habits, which causes them to become even more depressed. It's important to connect with other people so you don't become too isolated.
So one way of not falling into depression, make sure you can connect with other people. And the great thing about the truth is you got many brothers and sisters that you can connect to, so your mind doesn't trap you in that thought of depression and you begin to eat yourself to death. Go ahead.
Talking with friends and a therapist can provide support.
Now, what do you call therapists in the truth? Counselors. Don't waste your money on that. You got leadership counsel. You got brothers counsel. You got sisters counsel you. You ain't got to waste your money on that. God gave you the answers in the book of life. Go ahead.
Can provide support to help you break out of that cycle, she says. Here are three common ways clinical depression can impact your eating patterns.
Now, read number one.
Number one. Using food for comfort.
Using food for comfort. Now, many of us have done that. And it's been many different situations. You might use food for comfort. You might have had rejection from a woman, rejection from a man. You might even grown up without a father in the household or grew up in an abusive household with your parents. And you seen things that was traumatizing to the mind. And you weren't even conscious of it. You use food to comfort yourself through those hard ordeals that you went through. And before you know it, in a year, you done gained 10, 15, 20 pounds. And then your cousins that ain't seen you in a while come back and see, but oh, you done got big? I ain't talking about tall either. But some of us might be in those situations. And now hindsight 2020, it ain't too late to change it. Read it real quick.
People with depression often use food to self-medicate.
Now scroll down where it says they may eat.
They may eat.
Right there.
They may eat to improve or avoid negative or uncomfortable feelings.
See what I'm saying? All Israel's been in negative and uncomfortable feelings. We grew up in negative environments, uncomfortable situations, and food was our friend. Read on.
Like sadness, shame, and self-loathing.
Read on.
Many people crave carbohydrates or soothing comfort foods, such as ice cream and cake, when they're depressed. One reason for this...
Ice cream and cake. Go ahead, Cap.
Hey, that explains why that ice cream truck always driving by. How often that ice cream truck go by our house? Even growing up in the hood, I mean, it's the same thing. You would always see... 3 or 4 ice cream trucks. It don't be the same one either.
Nah.
It'd be different ones driving right by in the hood, in the neighborhood.
All of us run out there to spend the money and get it, man. All right, let's go back to the article. Eating and
one reason for this.
Many people, read that again.
Many people crave carbohydrates or soothing comfort foods, such as ice cream and cake, when they're depressed. One reason for this is that foods high in carbs and sugar increase levels of serotonin, a brain chemical that elevates mood.
Now, we went over that serotonin before. That's that feel good in the brain. They're like, yes, this makes me feel good. Keep on filling yourself with this so I can keep on feeling this way. And it ain't no cutoff from that. The only cutoff of that feel good is when your stomach has expanded and your stomach then tells you, okay, that's enough. Then you stop. But if you're with that serotonin, if you never got full, you'll just keep on going. You'll just keep on going. There's tests where they've tested it on rats. They eat until their stomach burst. Read that in the short term.
In the short term,
we got a lot to go through. Go ahead.
In the short term, eating foods high in sugar and fat may make you feel calmer or and cared for, Fan says. But in the long term, a steady diet of comfort foods can lead to weight gain and increase your risk of heart disease, diabetes, and other serious health problems.
Pay attention to those three things right there. We're going to hit on those later. Let's go down to number two. Scroll up. It's on the next page? Okay, go ahead. Oh, X that out. There we go.
Number two, eating too little.
Uh-huh.
Many people find their appetite decreases when they're feeling low. In some cases, they end up unintentionally losing weight. They have less desire for food, and they start skipping meals. Often, they're sleeping through meals.
Now, jump down to the next paragraph.
Albert says that you may feel like you don't have the motivation or energy to eat when you're depressed. Also, stress can play a role in reducing your appetite. Food isn't as appealing when you're anxious, worried, or feel hopeless.
Read on.
She says, but not eating enough can make you more irritable and sensitive, which can worsen your depression.
We've all been through that. We all been through that situation where we just didn't feel like eating. You lay in the bed all day. And you just stay there. Read it. Next one.
Number three, eating whatever is easily available.
Mm-hmm.
Shopping for and preparing healthy meals can seem daunting when you're depressed and lacking energy. As a result, you may reach for foods that are convenient, but they aren't particularly nutritious, and you may not get enough variety in your diet.
Now, how many of us can attest to that? We go right there to the daggone Checkers, the White Castles, the Crystals, the names of all the Sonic, the McDonald's, the Burger Kings, the Chick-fil-A, the KFC, the Popeyes. We as a people are the ones that keep those places open. It's not the other nations. They stay afloat by us.
Hey, Cap, those stores are not even there
right.
As far as area. It's always in our area, the low-income area.
Yep.
You see them every other block, there's a McDonald's. I've never seen some McDonald's in my life. Now they're building on Wawa's. Wawa's is starting to be another fast food, but it's mixed with gas station.
Yeah, yeah.
But now they're trying to make it into a fast food restaurant as well, 24/7.
And you know what? Shoot, and what I did one time, you know, I'm a driver. So while I'm driving, I actually look and to see if people are actually sitting there. I'm talking about it's daytime. People are supposed to be at work. But you look at every one of them, like here go Burger King on one corner. You look in, people are sitting down and eating.
Yeah.
You drive down the block, there's another Burger King or McDonald's. People are sitting down and eating.
Right.
I'm talking about a block apart. Mm-hmm. People are in there eating. Yep. Tell you.
Hey, I fell to that too, because I remember once I was driving, I said, damn, I missed that McDonald's. I said, two blocks, there's going to be another one.
Dang.
I was like that. I was like, damn.
All of us have fell into this. That's why we're going over this, so we can get some healing from it. Give me that in Song of Solomon. Now, you see where it talked about comfort food, right? We choose junk, but look what our forefathers did. Read that. Song of Solomon, chapter 2, and I want to read verse 5. This is changing your mindset. This is how you should comfort yourself. Song of Solomon 2, verse 5.
Songs of Solomon, chapter 2, and verse 5. Stay me with flagons.
Flagons is clusters of raisins. Go ahead.
Comfort me with apples.
Comfort with what?
Comfort me with apples.
And now look at that. There's a different option for comfort food. Now, we understand that Song of Solomon is on a different, it's a wisdom book, so it's different levels of understanding to it. But why do you think the Most High used that particular metaphor to get across what he truly wanted to mean? Because those apples are sweet. They can comfort you. And it's many different versions of apples. Read that again. So for anybody get depressed, this is what you should grab. Read that again.
Stay me with flagons.
Which is raisins. Go ahead.
Comfort me with apples.
Comfort with apples. Go ahead.
For I am sick of love.
So when he was feeling bad, He ate apples to comfort himself. He was lovesick. Give me an apple. Somebody give me an apple. That was our comfort food. We got to rehearse the righteous acts once again, right? Give me that in 1 Peter chapter 5. Let's show you about this one. I want to let you know about this depression. Tap into that one more time. If you know, with that thought, so we can, if that happens to us again and we start thinking about those comfort foods, we can automatically trigger this scripture within our spirit and stop ourselves. Read that 1 Peter 5 on 7 on down.
1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 7. Casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you.
Send up some prayers. Go ahead.
Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour.
And the devil may use a certain lust against you, which can be what? Comfort foods. Oh, you feel bad. Go get something to eat. Go get some fast food to eat. That Satan can use that to destroy your temple also. Read verse 9.
Verse 9. Whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world.
So that go back. Let you know, if you feel in that moment of depression, your thoughts are getting the best of you, understand you ain't the only one going through it, the Bible's saying. Like it said in that, it says, be in contact with other people. Call somebody on the phone. I'm feeling this way because somebody else is feeling that way too. And it can get you through that moment of craving that comfort food that is not good for you. And you can grab your apple somewhere and you come to your sisters, right? Let's go to the second article. Science news article, because food traps, like you said, it leads to underlying health conditions. Food traps lead to underlying health conditions. Pull up that second article, Science News. Let's read that.
Why African Americans may be especially vulnerable to COVID-19.
Scroll down. Let's read that.
COVID-19.
Real quick, let's read through that quick.
COVID-19 was called the great equalizer. Nobody was immune. Anybody could succumb, but the virus spread across the United States is exposing racial fault lines, with early data showing that African Americans are more likely to die from the disease than white Americans.
Why? Because we have underlying conditions from eating comfort food through this struggle of captivity that our brothers and sisters in the world have absolutely no answers for. Absolutely no answers for the oppression that we have been living through for the last four centuries here in Babylon. So what has been their comfort? Food, and it has destroyed our health. Read that.
The data are still piecemeal, with only some states and countries breaking down COVID-19 cases.
Okay, now let's jump down. Let's go down to where it says reasons we are vulnerable to COVID-19. Hold on, go up right there. Number one.
The number one reason, African Americans are more likely to be exposed to COVID-19.
We exposed to it. Go ahead.
SARS, CoV-2, the coronavirus that causes COVID-19, is highly contagious even before symptoms appear. So to curb the virus, spread the limit person-to-person transmission. States have been issuing stay-at-home orders, but many individuals are considered part of the critical workforce by the U.S. Department of Homeland Security.
Now, look at it. It said critical workforce. I'm gonna explain that to you in a different way. Black people are the reason why America is still standing. I'm just saying it to you in a different way. We built the place and we maintain the place. That's what it means by critical work service. Go back to it. Let's go back to the article. It says critical workforce by the U.S. Department. They work all the jobs that we don't want to work to keep the place up. Go read the next. And must continue.
And must continue to work. That includes caregivers, cashiers, sanitation workers, farm workers, and public transition.
Damn, that's critical. That's bottom of the barrel jobs.
Jobs often filled by African Americans.
We built the place and we maintain the place. Sanitation workers. No wonder you only see black garbage truck not even drivers. They be the people on the back. And it'd be maybe another black dude driving it, or oftentimes a white dude driving a truck. caregivers. That's the ones that got to take care of the elderly that can't take care of themselves. You know what goes into that. That's close contact with people. Read the next part. For instance,
almost 30% of employed African Americans work in the education and health services industry and 10% in retail, according to 2019 data from the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics. African Americans are less likely than employed people in general to work in professional and business services. Mm-hmm. The sorts of jobs more amenable to telecommunication.
Now scroll down some. Let me see. Go up some. Okay. Keep going. No. Scroll down. Now read. Keep reading.
Driving solo of those jobs isn't always an option among urban residents. About 34% of African Americans
use transit regularly,
compared with 14% of white people.
That means we're on the bus or the train. Go ahead.
According to a 2016 report from...
Hey, move the thing, y'all. Come on. Pay attention back here. Go ahead.
According to
we ain't
got to
read all
of
that. Just get to the stuff. I ain't worried about their titles.
Continued use of public transit during the pandemic may bring African Americans into greater contact with infected people.
Go ahead.
Additionally, a proportionately high percentage of African Americans may live in places that could increase the risk of exposure. Census data from January 2020.
Projects. Go ahead.
Census data from January 2020 show that only 44% of African Americans own their own home, compared with almost 74% of white people. Consider a family living in a crowded inner city apartment, says epidemiologist Martina Anto Orkwa of the University of Rochester.
Yeah, we ain't got to read all that stuff, man. Just get
African Americans' risk of higher exposure of COVID-19 has historical roots, including legal segregation.
Now pay attention to this part. Go ahead.
Including legal segregation in schools and in housing, discrimination in the labor market, and redlining, the practice of denying home loans to those living in predominantly African-American neighborhoods. Those forces have contributed to persistent racial wealth gap. The African-Americans continue to struggle to move into neighborhoods with the sorts of social economic opportunities that allow white families to better avoid exposure to COVID-19.
Now, because there's more space in the suburbs, right? Basically what it's saying. Now read number two.
Number two, African Americans have a higher incidence of underlying health conditions.
There we go. Let's talk about comfort foods lead to underlying health conditions. Read on.
Among those at highest risk of getting severely ill with COVID-19 are patients with other serious health problems, such as hypertension, diabetes, and heart disease.
Now, we just read that, didn't we? Comfort foods create all of that stuff. Go ahead.
Over 40% of African Americans have high blood pressure.
Over 40%. Go ahead.
Among the highest rates in the world.
In the world.
According to the American
Heart Association,
by comparison, about a third white Americans have high blood pressure. Similarly, African Americans tend to have higher rates of diabetes. Mm-hmm. Part of the heightened risk has to do with African Americans' disproportionate exposure to air pollution.
Air pollutions. How many of us lived in the hood where the factories were? How many of us lived by highways? You live in the hood where all these cars and you got these buildings that keep the pollution right in your area. Go ahead.
There's even places in the city where there's no trees. And you know, some of the trees filter that.
Yeah.
You got cities like Chicago, New York. There's no plantation around. There's nothing but concrete.
Yeah. All concrete.
Yeah. I grew up in a projects and inside of projects in Morris, all around is about at least 8 buildings just in circle among each other. And it's nothing going on. It's no air. It's all just cluttered.
Yeah.
All cluttered.
Now, we all know that's where we used to be hot in the neighborhood. You know why? It wasn't no wind blowing through there because the buildings blocked all the wind. You had to put a fan in the window to cool down. Go back to the article. So it talked about air pollution, right?
Such pollution has been linked to chronic health problems.
Chronic health problems. Go ahead.
Including asthma, obesity, and cardiovascular disease. In April 2019, study in the Proceedings of the National Academic of Science.
Skip all that stuff. Go straight to showed that poor
African-American neighborhoods have higher levels of lead, air pollution, and violence than poor white neighborhoods.
You know why we got higher levels of lead? Because we living in old houses. Go ahead.
Researchers are still sorting out how neighborhood stressors contribute to poor health. But even if the causes aren't always clear, research suggests that helping people move to better neighborhoods can improve health.
They're not going to do that. All right, let's go to the next one.
Number three, African Americans have less access to medical care and often distrust caregivers.
Yeah, go ahead.
Inequities in access to health care, including inadequate health insurance, discrimination fears, and distance from clinics and hospitals, make it harder for many African Americans to access the sort of preventive care that keeps chronic disease in check.
All right, let's go to the next article called The Black Plague. Let's go to that next article, The Black Plague. And on this, yeah, The Black Plague. Now this is going to go into letting you know where it was talking about the areas that we live in, how it has created the Black Plague amongst us. Read that.
We're going to read down plague. To
where it talks about zip codes.
The old African-American aporism, when white America catches a cold, Black America gets pneumonia.
Right.
Has a new morbid twist. When white Americans catches the novel coronavirus, Black Americans die.
So it's always worse for us. That's what he's saying. Go ahead.
Thousands of white Americans have also died from the virus, but the pace at which African Americans are dying has transformed this public health crisis into an object lesson in racial and class inequality, according to a Reuters report. African Americans are more likely to die of COVID-19 than any other group in the U.S. It is still early in the course of the pandemic, and the demographic data is incomplete. But the partial view is enough to prompt a sober reflection on its bitter harvest of American racism.
Go ahead.
Louisiana, which more than 21,000 reported infections, has the largest number of coronavirus cases outside the Northeast and Midwest.
Jump down to the next paragraph.
The small city of Albany, Georgia, 200 miles south of Atlanta, which the site of heroic civil rights standoff between the city's Black residents and its white police chief in early 1960s. Today, more than 1,200 people in the country have confirmed COVID-19 cases, and at least 78 people have died. According to early reports, 81% of the dead are African American.
Out of the 78, 81% of it is us. Read on.
The virus has shaken In Michigan, African Americans make up 14% of the state's population, but currently they account for 33% of its reported infections, or 40% of its death.
And 40% of its death, right? Now jump down to that next paragraph about Chicago.
The virus has shaken African Americans in Chicago, who account for 52% of the city's confirmed cases and a startling 72% of deaths.
72% of the deaths, right? Let's go to the next paragraph.
As many has already noted, the macabre roll call reflects the fact that African Americans are more likely to have pre-existing health conditions that make the coronavirus particularly deadly. Mm-hmm. This is certainly true. These conditions, diabetes, asthma, heart disease, and obesity, are critical factors, and they point to the persistence of racial discrimination, which has long heightened Black vulnerability to premature death. As the scholar Ruthie Wilson Gilmore has said for years, racism in the shadow of American slavery has diminished almost all of the life chances of African Americans.
Slavery has diminished almost all of the life chances of Black people. Basically, you born to die here. That's it. That's what it's saying. And people be like, oh, slavery so far is a long time ago. You still got lasting effects of it. Go back to it. Let's read that.
Black people are poor, more likely to be unreemployed, underemployed, condemned to substandard housing, and given inferior health care because of their race. These factors explain why African Americans are 60% more likely to have been diagnosed with diabetes than white Americans, and why Black women are 60% more likely to have high blood pressure than white women. Mm. Such health disparities are as much markers of racial inequality as mass incarceration or house discrimination.
Read that next paragraph real quick.
It is easy to simply point to the prevalence of these health conditions among African Americans as the most important explanation of the rising death rates. But it is also important to acknowledge that black vulnerability is especially heightened by the continued ineptitude of the federal government in response of the coronavirus.
Uh-huh.
The mounting carnage in Trump's America did not have to happen to the extent that it has. COVID-19 testing remains Mattingly inconsistent and unavailable, with access breaking down along the predictable lines.
I got it. It's too predictable in the predictable lines. In Philadelphia, a science at Drexel, blah, blah, blah. It says in zip codes with a lower proportion of minorities and higher incomes, a higher number of tests were administered. So now you understand why so many black people die so much. They didn't send the test to where the black people are. Pull it back up. In zip codes with a higher number of unemployed and uninsured residents, there were fewer tests. Taken together, testing in higher income neighborhoods is 6 times greater than it is in poor neighborhoods. So you wonder why so many black people have been dying with it. You got underlying health conditions. And when you saw those videos of them doing drive-by testing, that wasn't nowhere near where black people live. So we didn't have a choice, but we coughing, get a cough. Oh, I got a cold. Next thing you know, you was dropping dead. Give me that in Psalms chapter 10. So we got to be conscious of these things. Psalms chapter 10. Let's read 2-4. Then we're going to jump.
Psalms chapter 10.
Verse 2.
Uh-huh. The wicked in his pride do persecute the poor.
The wicked in his pride persecute the poor. That's what's happening right there. Go ahead.
Let them be taken in the devices that they have imagined. For the wicked boasteth of his heart's desire and blesseth the covetous whom the Lord abhorreth. The wicked, Through the pride of his countenance, will not seek after God. God is not in all his thoughts.
God is not in all his thoughts. So whenever things are starting to go bad, don't look for love thy neighbor as thyself. That is not about to happen when things start to go bad. They're going to love themselves as they love themselves. You excluded from that. Jump down to verse 8.
He sitteth in the lurking places of the villages. In the secret places doth he murder the innocent.
That's the poor. That's the projects. Go ahead.
His eyes are privily set against the poor. He lieth in wait secretly as a lion in his den. He lieth in wait to catch the poor. He do catch the poor when he draweth him into his net.
Mm-hmm.
He croucheth.
That net is what? That net can be the fast food restaurants, the food deserts, the corner store where you go get your food from. That's how he catch you in the net. You ain't got nowhere to go. You ain't going to get on the bus and drive an hour and a half to go to Whole Foods because you can't afford a car because you got low-paying jobs. You can't afford a car. You ain't got money to take an Uber. It's more convenient for me to go right here at the corner store and get that comfort food that I want. Read on, verse 10.
He croucheth and humbleth himself, that the poor may fall by his strong ones.
If you vote for me, I plan to put in a policy to increase the better health and lower the discrepancies between white and black Americans when it comes to health care. I promise all adequate health care for all low incomes. Ain't gonna say black, low income and poor families if you vote for me. That's how he got you trapped. Let me vote for him. Go ahead.
Verse 11. He has said in his heart, God hath forgotten. He hideth his face. He will never see it.
Go to Psalms 4:4. So understanding dealing with the enemies, knowing that, we have to do this. Psalms 4:4.
Psalms chapter 4:4. Stand in awe and sin not. Commune with your own heart upon your bed and be still. Salah.
Now, commune with your own heart, what does that mean? Examine yourself. That's another way of saying McDaniel. Think about your daily eating habits, your eating habits in the past, where you are at this point in your life, health-wise. Think about that. Am I doing what is pleasing to the Most High to take care of the temple that was loaned to me? Only you know that. You have to commune with your own self. I know people be like, don't talk. This is a good time to talk to yourself. Read that scripture. Be like, do I eat right? No, I don't eat right. No, you don't eat right. You know you don't eat right. Let me stop lying. That's a good time to talk to yourself. When you examine it, am I doing what's right according to God? In the situation that we in, understand that our enemies shoot at us in the secret places. Right? Go to it. You got something? Go ahead, Kevin.
No, I just wanted to say this. Don't wait till you on your deathbed, y'all.
Oh, that's what they would commute.
Commute. Don't wait while you on your deathbed, and then next thing you know, you can't hardly breathe. Mm. You're catching headaches on the left side of your head, and then you're like, you know what? What did I eat to get me here?
Damn.
Oh, man.
It's too late then, ain't it?
Don't do it. Come on, Israel.
That's deep, Cap. Don't commune on your deathbed about the way you've been eating all your life. Do it before you get there. And the reason why we've got to examine ourselves and think about way we eat, and because it leads to underlying health conditions, is because we see that what rules Esau in this captivity, it's money. You see they protesting, open back up America. You know, it's only been a few weeks since they shut the thing down. And they like, nah, no more staying in the house. I'm protesting. Let me get my rifles. We got the signs. Let us back out. Open back up these stores because money drives them. Money is the God that they trust in. That's why it's printed on the money. So understanding the situation we in, living amongst our enemies, we now have to go into what is called preventative measures, because there ain't no cure. They might open back stuff back up, but it ain't no cure to the coronavirus that once it attaches to people with underlying health conditions, it'll kill you. There ain't no cure to it. So we have to go into preventative medicine. And the first and foremost way is to what? Leave off from sin, right? And then we have to change what we put into our body to improve our immune system. Go to Ecclesiastes chapter 2, and I want to read 4 and 5. Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verse 4 and 5. Let's see what our forefathers used to boost their immune system. Read that.
Ecclesiastes chapter 2 and verse 4.
Uh-huh.
I made me great works. I builded me houses. I planted me vineyards.
Look what Solomon did. I planted me vineyards. Go ahead.
I made me gardens and orchards, and I planted trees in them of all kind of fruits.
Look how our forefathers boosted their immune system. Planted vineyards, planted gardens, planted trees of all kinds of fruits. Now, check this out. We are not in that position where we have space to do all of that stuff. But the Lord has been gracious enough to us in this captivity to where it's provided at different types of stores where we can go and buy those things. It's readily available to us that we can go and buy fruits. We can buy vegetables when we don't have our own garden or trees to pick from it. Read that again, verse 4 and 5.
I made me great works. I builded me houses. I planted me vineyards. I made me gardens and orchards. And I planted trees in them of all kind of fruits.
All kinds of fruit. Now give me that fourth article of healthy vegetables to grow in your garden. Healthy vegetables. Read that.
13 of the healthiest vegetables to grow in your garden.
13 of them. These packed with vitamins, vegetables, plants will bring good taste and good health to your garden and to your table. Let's read the 13. Read that.
Broccoli.
Broccoli. Let's read it. Read that.
Want to greatly reduce your risk of a whole host of disease, including cancer? Grow broccoli, a fall and spring vegetable that grows best in sunny site. And a sunny site and well-drained soil.
Now, we all hate broccoli. Everybody hate broccoli. Oh, I hate broccoli. It's ways to season broccoli. It's ways to do that. And it says it keep a whole host of diseases, maybe even cancer, away from you. Let's go to the next one. Let's see the picture. Scroll up so we can see the picture.
Kale.
Kale, right? Let's scroll down. Read kale. It quick.
Frost actually enhances the taste of this cold weather crop.
Cool weather.
Packed with vitamins and minerals, this dark leafy green, sometimes referred to as the queen of greens, is low in calories, high in fiber and antioxidants, and rich in iron, vitamin K, A, and C.
Just go back up to the pictures and go to the next one. Let's see what those are.
Sweet potato.
Oh!
I'm growing those right now as we speak.
All praises.
Quarantine life, y'all. So I'm growing. I watched a video on YouTube where you don't even need that much space, and you could grow your own sweet potatoes in your backyard.
All praises.
That's it, y'all.
Let's go. Let's skip through them for sake of time. So we got sweet potato. Scroll down so we can see the pictures.
Spinach.
Okay, that's good right there. Next one.
Carrots. Brussels sprouts.
Oh, Brussels. Brussels sprouts are good when you steam them, you do it right. Brussels sprouts are good, and they healthy. You can go back and read the article later. I'll post it. Healthy vegetables to grow in your garden. Read on. Go to the next picture. Cauliflower. Everybody hate cauliflower. I know you do, but it's ways to make it taste good. Go ahead.
Garlic.
Uh-huh.
Avocados.
Them some good things. I eat them.
Tomatoes. Blueberries.
I want to read blueberries real quick. Read that with blueberries. Let's see what it say. Read that real quick.
A real superfood. Blueberries are packed with antioxidants and can help with memory loss and reduce eye strain.
So you brothers that forget precepts, you sisters, eat some blueberries. Go ahead.
Among many other benefits. Better yet, as they ripen in your garden, you can easily add a handful or a few, depending upon your yield, to a bowl of cereal or to a smoothie.
Let's go to the next one. Scroll up. Next one.
Figs.
Okay, next one.
Cabbage.
There we go. Love it. Let's go to the next article of the healthiest fruits. So that was 13 of the best vegetables to grow in your garden. Now let's see, go up to the top. So come on, man, work with me, y'all. We gotta see titles.
Top 12 healthy fruits.
12 healthy fruits. Cause remember, he said I got fruits from the trees, right? Scroll down. Let's just get to it. Number one, go down. There we go.
Lemons.
We can't see that, y'all. Can y'all see that? We can't see that. Can y'all see that on the computer? Cause we can't see it. There you go.
Lemons.
Okay, lemons. Let's go to the next one.
Strawberries.
Okay. So just imagine. He said, I planted trees in them of all kinds of fruits. Just imagine. These could have been some of the things that Solomon had in his garden. Go ahead.
Oranges.
Next.
Limes. Grapefruit.
Oh, I don't like grapefruit. I ain't gonna lie to you. I don't like grapefruit. I do not like grapefruit, man. Ah! Ugh! Go ahead.
Blackberries.
Next one.
Apples.
There we go.
Pomegranate.
Okay.
Pineapple.
I like some pineapple.
Bananas. Avocado
on the list twice. Go ahead.
Blueberries
on that list again. So those are the top 12 healthiest fruits, right? Now let's go to Jeremiah 29. Let's read 4 and 5. Watch this, y'all. Watch what the Lord says. Jeremiah 29, 4 and 5.
Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 4. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, unto all that are carried away captives, whom I have caused to be carried away from Jerusalem unto Babylon.
And we are in Babylon the Great now. We're in captivity, right? Look how he spoke to our forefathers. Read.
Build thee houses and dwell in them and plant gardens.
So God even tell you in captivity, make sure you're eating your vegetables. That's a good father right there. Make sure you eat your vegetables, son. Make sure you eat your vegetable, daughters. I'm going to send you out to captivity, but I still want you to watch your health. Don't just say, are we in captivity? This is all we got. No, the Lord said, put some good food in your body. Plant gardens. Read.
Plant gardens and eat the fruit of them.
Read it again, that last part, and do what?
And eat the fruit of them.
Read that part again.
And eat the fruit of them.
God telling you, even in your captivity, eat the fruit. Eat fruit. Even in captivity, the Lord knows what kind of health benefits it got. And I already know, I started to get a little more, because I ain't no bodybuilder or no daggone raw vegan type person, right? But before I even got a little bit more health conscious, I could attest to it. Fruits and vegetables was not my main course of meal. Like many of us, it is not our main course of meal. But now, in us waking up and our eyes being enlightened, God said, you going to captivity? Eat the vegetables and eat the fruit. Eat the fruit. It got so many health benefits amongst your enemies that can protect you while you are here serving out the punishment. 2 Samuel 16, and let's read verse 1.
The book of 2 Samuel, chapter 16 and verse 1.
Yep.
And when David was a little past the top of the hill, behold, Ziba, the servant of Mephibosheth, met him with a couple of asses saddled, and upon them 200 loaves of bread.
200 loaves of bread.
And 100 bunches of raisins.
A bunch of raisins.
And 100 of summer fruits.
He had what?
And 100 of summer fruits.
Look at this. Look how our forefathers, look at their regular meals. I know we read Leviticus 11 and they talk about all that meat we can eat, but we throw away and discount how our forefathers really got down when it came to eating. That lets you know how far we have been disconnected from our true heritage. But that's why we're going over this class today, so we can get back to rehearsing those righteous acts. Read that again. It said, and 100 bunches of raisins.
And 100 of summer fruits.
All type of fruits. Go ahead.
And a bottle of wine.
And a bottle of wine. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 8. Let's read 7 through 9.
Deuteronomy chapter 8 and verse 7.
Yep, let's read that.
For the Lord thy God bringeth thee into a good land.
Into a good land. Now, you want to know what, when it says the land of milk and honey? Here's the precept for it right here. This is what it means going into that land of milk and honey. Read that.
For the Lord thy God bringeth thee into a good land, a land of brooks of water.
Water everywhere.
Of fountains and depths that spring out of the valleys and hills.
Uh-huh. So we had our own Zephyr Hills. We had our own Zephyr Hills in the land that we come from, y'all. Our own spring water. Read on.
A land of wheat and barley and vines and fig trees and pomegranates. A land of oil, olive, and honey. A land wherein thou shalt eat bread without scarceness.
Uh-huh.
Thou shalt not lack anything in it. A land whose stones are iron. And out of whose hills thou mayest dig brass.
So I just mentioned about being disconnected from our heritage. We have forgotten what type of people that we truly was. When we came out of the land of Egypt, we've forgotten that we lived on the field. We lived out the field. We were farmers. That's what we did. Go to Leviticus chapter 26. Let's read 2 through 5.
Leviticus chapter 26, verse 2.
Uh-huh.
Ye shall keep my Sabbath and reverence my sanctuary.
Now, what's the sanctuary today that we reverence means to respect? What's the sanctuary we supposed to respect today? We read it early in Corinthians, the temple of your body. God says, respect that thing that he has given you. Read on.
I am the Lord. If ye walk in my statutes and keep my commandments and do them, then I will give you rain in due season, and the land shall yield her increase, and the trees of the field shall yield their fruit.
The trees will yield their fruit. Go ahead.
and your threshing shall reach unto the vintage, and the vintage shall reach unto the sowing time.
Meaning that the Lord is going to populate those trees with so much fruit that you ain't going to be able to eat all of it. It's going to grow so much. You won't even be able to eat all of it before the next time that you are supposed to take it off. Read on.
And ye shall eat your bread to the full, and dwell in your land safely.
So understanding that we had a land that was full of fruits and veggies, and that's how we lived. Although we had other stuff to eat, but a lot of our plates, for lack of a better, was filled with vegetables and fruits, right? And understanding for people that don't have that type of diet, when you eat that stuff fills you up. That stuff does fill you up, because we've been trained to, I got to eat meat, chicken, and all that stuff to be full. But fruits and vegetables fill you up also. Right? Let's go to, give me that picture. Give me that picture. Fruit is what? What is fruit? Give me that picture. Fruit, replace nature, and what is it? Fruit is God's candy. Fruit is God's candy. So maybe you got a sweet tooth, right? Because a lot of us grew up eating candies. Some of us still eat Snickers and things of that nature, and Kit Kats and whatever else you might think of to get that sweet. Honey bun, or we eat that stuff to satisfy that sweet tooth. Fruit is God's candy. Let's prove it. Prove it. Go to Song of Solomon chapter 2, and let's read verse 3. Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 3.
Song of Solomon, chapter 2, and verse 3. As the apple tree among the trees of the wood, so is my beloved among the sons. Uh-huh. I sat down under his shadow with great delight, and his fruit was sweet to my taste.
His what?
His fruit was sweet to my taste.
So maybe you got a sweet tooth. I know Zahira got a sweet tooth, right? But what has she now replaced that with? With fruits. She got me on that stuff. You know what? I don't know a lot of people, you know, if y'all eat fruits, whatever. But I've come to like honeydew. Honeydew is very sweet, man. I'm telling you, that thing tastes good. That's my candy. When I'm not weak in the spirit. That's my candy, the honeydew. And the Lord's telling you the fruits are sweet. So if you got sweet tooth, start adding more fruits to your diet to curb that, because the fruits of the sweets that we use here in Babylon to satisfy that desire is chock full of what? Like sugar and things of that nature that end up destroying you, rot your teeth, things of that nature, right? So we got to be able to just transition over into what comes from God. Give me that give me that video. It's a video called Superfoods. Give me the video called Superfoods. Pay attention to this video, y'all. Superfoods. Play it.
Some foods are better than others. And that's the whole premise of this talk. And we're going to talk about the ones that are deemed super because they have lots of characteristics that make them better than others. So even though there are a lot of foods out there that are good for you, they have to have many different characteristics that are good for you to be considered super. These foods that I'm going to talk to you about will help prevent cardiovascular disease, my specialty, type 2 diabetes. More than half of my patients have diabetes.
Black people.
Hypertension, 90% of my patients have hypertension.
Black people.
Certain cancers, I'd say a good fourth of my patients have cancer. Okay, so broccoli, oranges, spinach, and then there's other things going with spinach. Blueberries, those are really good and they freeze very well. Pumpkin, not just for Halloween. Turkey, not just for Thanksgiving. Soy, yogurt, whole grains. Now, you know, people are getting on the bandwagon, they're saying whole grains. It truly needs to be whole grains. It can't be whole grains to start with and then processed to oblivion. Walnuts, very, very good. And there's all the sidekicks for walnuts, including the peanuts and macadamia nuts that I have. Tea, so those that are coffee drinkers,
might want to consider having a cup of tea every once in a while.
Oh, capsaicin?
Wild salmon, not the farm kind, the wild salmon. And beans, not just the kind that are musical, okay? And tomatoes. It's not just about avoiding disease, though. It's about feeling good. It's not just the last fourth to a third of your life that's affected. It's every single day. If you can switch over to these superfoods, you will feel a whole lot better.
All right. That's what she says. A lot of it is heavy. Now look at this. I wanted you to understand this. And while I was watching that video, it dawned on me. Since Adam's sin, the judgment is that thou shalt die the death. It says that, right, in the scriptures. But along that whole time that the Lord has given us, the month, the day, in that meantime, if we eat better, we can feel better in that time before the Lord calls us home. We don't have to have bad health and just mosey on through life until the Lord calls us home. You can feel good along with not sinning until the Lord does decide to call us home, just by changing our habit. Now, you know, everybody's body is different. I ain't claiming to be a doctor, so you eat out of that superfood stuff, whatever is best for your body. Some people did research on this and say, oh, I don't want to eat that, or I heard different about that. Well, do your own research on it, but understand changing over to eating some of those things is going to benefit you in the long run on a daily basis if you change your diet. Now, even when you watch that, you see, you don't even have to give up meat. You don't have to give up meat. You just got to eat better. That's it. That's why I like that video, because it has some meat, because people are like, oh, he tried to push veganism on us. Oh, no, I'm not trying to do that. You see that? You can, it's certain type of foods that are better than others. One thing we all got to come to the understanding of, it ain't that many damn cows in the world for it to be so many burger chains. You know, you got the daggone Five Guys with the big burger stuff. You got Checkers. You got Checkers, Big Burgers. You got Big Macs, McDonald's. You got little bitty burgers at White Castle. It ain't that damn many cows in there. If you look it up, the FDA has already approved this. Only a certain amount of meat that has to be in it for it to be considered sellable to the public. We know that. But we just got to change our mentality and break away from that stuff, right? Go to the next video. So you don't have to give up meat. You just got to eat better. Look what the next video says here. Fruits and veggies. Pull that up. Play that for us.
Fruits and vegetables are a great source of vitamins and minerals. And eaten fresh, they typically don't contain substances that can be harmful to your health, like fat, sodium, and extra calories.
Some of the current research is cancer prevention, heart disease, from not only the vitamins and minerals that are a good source from that, but from the phytochemicals, the anthocyanin pigments, the colors of the vegetables. So there's a good idea to eat a rainbow colors, vegetables, many different things.
Eating more fruits and veggies will also help your waistline.
They're low density foods.
Pause
that
it
means
right,
they
real
don't
quick.
Have a lot of.
Now, a reason why a lot of us gain weight as the older we have gotten is because we've gotten busier. I'll use that as a first excuse. The second one is we have gotten lazy, including myself. I got some weights at home, and I got to be reminded by my wife to lift them. You know, we've gotten busy, and we've gotten lazy. So to curb that of us not going to the gym, what can you do? Fruits and veggies will slim that waistline down. It'll do it naturally, because as you hear her talk, it is low in density. That means that you eat it, it ain't gonna sit in your stomach and create fat. That's what it's talking about. We got a few brothers here that already claim they dense. Go back to the video. Shout out to Officer Lyle, the dense brother of the body. Play that video.
The calories. And so they're a good way to help maintain a healthy weight.
The United States Department of Agriculture recommends 4 to 5 servings each of fruits and vegetables, so as many as 10 servings a day.
That may sound like a lot, but if you consider a banana is 2 servings and a large apple is 2, well, there's 4 right there.
There you go.
Add a salad and a cooked vegetable.
We didn't know that.
Close to the goal.
Pause it. Now, see, those are things that we didn't know. 5 servings, bananas 2, and an apple's another 2. You halfway through. You can eat that for on your 10-minute break. You can eat that on lunch. You can eat the banana in the morning and the apple on your first break or something. And then you're halfway through. These is things that we don't. You know why we don't think about this? It's because we was not raised to think like this. We was raised on the plantations to eat the slop. Make the slop taste better, and we turn that slop into cuisine, and it has been passed down through the generations. And we have made slop our everyday food, and we even gave it a name. We call it what? Soul food. We even made a damn movie off of it. Yeah. That's literal slop that is packed on with high sodium seasoning to make it taste good. We was not trained to think in this way. Therefore, we don't even know the science behind the food that God gave us from the jump, the food that we ate on a regular in our own land with the trees of fruits and the vegetables and the vineyards and things. We don't know the health, the healthiness behind it, so we don't even think to eat it. Let's go ahead, Cap.
Even with the name soul food, what's that indicating? That it feels good.
Damn, good point.
It feels good. So the only time you're going to get that warm feeling with family and unity is by eating this food. Yep. So that's very dangerous.
Damn, good point. Good point. Let's go back to the video. Finish it out.
Fresh foods in season from farmers markets or even growing your own garden are good ways to get healthy fruits and vegetables into your diet. And preserving those in-season items by freezing them can help you during other times of the year.
And actually, they're a wonderful source because they usually don't have added salt. And frozen fruits, frozen berries are a good price.
Making half your plate fruits and vegetables at every meal can help make sure you're getting the right amount of these healthy foods in your diet.
There you go. Run that part back right there. Cause some people's like, oh, I can't do it. I done tried it so many times. I can't give it up. I tried to do you ain't got to be vegan. You ain't got to do none of that stuff. Just start putting more vegetables and fruits on your plate when you eat. You know what we do? We'll put a whole bunch of meat. We'll put a whole bunch of the other stuff. And then we'll save that little bitty corner on the side for the vegetables or the fruits. And you know how on the plate the fruit section little thing be the smallest? I got fruits and veggies on my plate. You got about 8 pieces of a pineapple on there. You got 8 pieces of pineapple and about a 0.5 ounces of a daggone vegetable on your plate. That's my vegetables right there. And you wonder why, my chest hurt. Oh, I got to go to the doctor. Oh, yeah, I went to the doctor. They put me on medication to bring my blood pressure down. We got to change the way we think. Go back to it. Play that part again.
Frozen berries are a good price.
Making half your plate fruits and vegetables at every meal can help make sure you're getting the right amount of these healthy foods in your diet.
Make half your plate, y'all. Discipline yourself to take care of God's temple and just make half the plate fruits and vegetables. You ain't got to make the whole plate. You ain't got that much discipline. You ain't got to make the whole plate fruits and vegetables. Make half the plate. Fruits and vegetables to honor and take care of God's temple in these trying times that we are in these last days. Now, go to Daniel chapter 1. I'm going to show you something. Daniel chapter 1, and I want to read verse 1.
Daniel chapter 1 and verse 1. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, unto Jerusalem and besieged it.
Now, this is around 603, right? This is around that time. Go ahead.
And the Lord gave Jehoiakim.
603 BC. Go ahead.
And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand with part of the vessels of the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shinar.
Shinar is now Iraq. So the ancient name for Iraq is Shinar, and the modern day name for Shinar is Iraq, okay? Read on.
To the house of his God. And he brought the vessels into the treasure house of his God.
Now jump down to verse 6.
Verse 6. Now among these were the children of Judah, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, unto whom the prince of the eunuchs gave names. For he gave unto Daniel the name of
Belteshazzar,
and to Hananiah of Shadrach, and to Mishael of Meshach, and Azariah of Abednego. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat.
Now the reason why I talk about he wouldn't defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, it wasn't that he was great eat unclean foods. No, he wasn't doing that. But remember, it's a certain way that we were commanded by God to kill our animals. It's a certain way. And remember, that law is not given to all nations. Y'all see how other nations get down, especially these Edomites. They will kill the meat. They will kill the animal and leave blood in it on purpose. That's how they get down. I don't know how other nations eat, but I know how Esau eat. Moab, through the turn, they eat it raw. They eat unclean foods. But this is what it's going into. The food was not up to the standards of us as Israel. That's why I say I don't want to defile myself with the king's meat, right? Read on.
Nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore, he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Now God had brought Daniel into favor and tender love with the prince of the eunuchs. And the prince of the eunuchs said unto Daniel, I fear my lord, the king, who hath appointed your meat and your drink. For why should he see your faces worse liking than the children which are of your sort? Then shall ye make me endanger my head to the king. Mm-hmm. Then said Daniel to Melzar, who the prince of the eunuchs had set over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, prove thy servants, I beseech thee, 10 days.
Test thy servants 10 days, read.
And let them give us pulse to eat.
Pulse is vegetables, read.
And water to drink.
So Daniel said, I don't want to eat meat for 10 days. Give me just vegetables and water, read.
Then let our countenances be looked upon before thee, and the countenance of the children that eat of the portion of the king's meat.
Read.
And as thou seest, deal with thy servants.
So see if I don't come out looking healthier than those that eat meat and gorge themselves in it in just 10 days. Read. 10-day diet. Right. Go ahead.
Then let our countenance be looked upon before thee, and the countenance of the children that eat of the portion of the king's meat. And as thou seest, deal with thy servants. So he consented to them in this matter and proved them 10 days. And at the end of the 10 days, their countenances appeared fairer and fatter in flesh than all the children which did eat the portion of the king's meat. Thus Melzer took away the portion of their meat and the wine that they should drink and gave them pulse.
So Daniel was eating more vegetables than anything, because fruits and vegetables do what? They make you feel better. They make you look better. We just saw the videos that backed that up with the doctors and stuff in those certain situations. Now we got it in the scripts where God is letting you know the more fruits and vegetables that you eat, it'll change your countenance. And you can do the research on that type of stuff, that fruits and vegetables stuff, it gives you clearer skin or clears up your skin, right? We understand that. And if you have even tried to change your diet and did it for a certain amount of weeks, you know when you put in fruits, vegetables, and water into your system, you immediately start feeling better in maybe 3, 4, 5 days. Within a week, you got much more energy. You do that thing for 2, 3 weeks, you feel the best you ever felt in your life. But we lack that discipline. And what are we all? It ain't really lacking the discipline. Is that we don't have the knowledge to continue that type of eating as a lifestyle, so we go back to what we know. We go back to the slave tradition. We go back to what we know. We go back to the comfort foods, because it's too much to do this. I wasn't raised this way. I don't know enough of these meals to keep on eating this way. Let me just go back to what I know. But we got example in the Bible of that stuff helping us, make us look better, make us feel better, right? Let's go to 2 Kings chapter 4.
Hey, Kat, now we should make a Daniel diet plan.
A Daniel? I think somebody came up with that in Israel before to try to get people things to eat, like meal plans, yeah, right? Meal they plan. Did. But we ain't doing that at Christian stuff. No, Daniel fast.
I ain't say no fast.
Oh, praises. Let's go to 2 Kings chapter 4. And I'm reading 38 through 41.
2 Kings chapter 4 and verse 38. And Elisha came again to Gilgal.
Now I want y'all to pay attention to this. Read that.
And there was a dearth in the land. And the sons of the prophets were sitting before him. And he said unto his servant, set on the great pot and seethe pottage for the sons of the prophets.
Uh-huh.
And one went out into the field to gather herbs.
Gather herbs. That H is silent, y'all. Herbs. To gather herbs out of the field. Read.
And found a wild vine.
Uh-huh.
And gathered thereof wild gourds of it. Wild gourds his lap full.
Gourds in his lap, right? There's more vegetables. Go ahead.
And came and shred them into the pot of the pottage, for they knew them not. So they poured out for the men to eat. And it came to pass, as they were eating of the pottage, that they cried out and said, O thou man of God!
O thou man of God!
There is death in the pot!
Uh-huh.
And they could not eat thereof.
Now, I want to, if you know, eating vegetables and fruits and all of that stuff, putting half of that on your plate, it does not mean it has to taste nasty. It does not mean you have to be like, oh, Lord, he's asking me, I ain't got no flavor. It does not mean it has to be death in the pot for you to get healthier. All right? It's ways to season the vegetables. Here's the proof. Read verse 41.
Verse 41. But he said, then bring meal. And he cast it into the pot.
Bring some meal. Go ahead.
And he said, Pour out for the people that they may eat. And there was no harm in the pot.
So the food don't have to be nasty, y'all. Just so you know, it don't have to be nasty in order to eat it. You don't have to deprive yourself of good tasting food. Just learn how to season it or whatever correctly so it ain't no death in the pot. I'm telling you right now, sisters, if you got death in the pot, your husband ain't going to eat it. Ain't no way you're going to get him to eat healthier. It ain't going down. It don't have to be nasty, okay? Now, go to Sirach 31:16. Sirach 31:16, because going into eating meat, because there, you know, there ain't no law that says thou shalt not eat meat. No, we ain't going back to the days before the flood. No, we're not doing that. That ain't what we pushing. All right, we're going to keep the law because we got to eat that lamb come Passover, baby.
That's right.
We're going to eat that thing. But read that in Sirach 31. Let's read 16 through 20 and see what the Lord advises us when it comes to eating meats.
Sirach chapter 31 and verse 16. Eat as it becometh a man, those things which are set before
thee. Now, I want to eat as it becometh a man. That, you know what that means? All of us have a certain level of appetite that we need to fill. I'm not going to eat the same as Captain Severus. I'm not going to eat the same as Officer Tobias. I'm not going to eat the same as Sarah. I got my own eating habits that fulfill me. So God said, eat as it becometh a man, based on your size and things of that nature. Eat until you get to that point of satisfaction. Read on.
And devour not, lest thou be hated. Leave off first for manner's sake. And be not unsatiable, lest thou offend.
Now, that's the point. Be not unsatiable. That unsatiable thing is when you are satisfied, but you don't feel that your stomach has been expanded full enough. So you know what you do? Give me another plate. Give me one more plate. Just a little bit more. Just a little bit more. You already satisfied, but now you become unsatiable. When you get to the point of being unsatiable, that's where the bad health and the weight begins to pile on, because you are gorging yourself. What did it say? You are devouring now. Read on.
When thou sittest among many, reach not thy hand out first of all.
Manners, go ahead.
A very little is sufficient for a man well nurtured.
A very little is sufficient for a man that eats healthy. Like I was saying, and you, like I said, when you eat these vegetables and these herbs and these fruits and things, like that, you'll be surprised how little you have to eat to feel full or satisfied. Right, and how long it is before you hungry again. You'll be surprised. We don't know these things because, once again, we was not trained to think in that manner of food. A lot of us, and you see how that video said superfoods, and the first thing she got into was fruits. A lot of us don't even consider fruit as food. We don't consider vegetables as food. We don't do that. But here's the proof. Go back to the days of old. Go to Genesis. We got to change our mindset. Genesis chapter 1, verse 29.
Genesis chapter 1 and verse 29. And God said, behold, I have given you every herb bearing seed, which is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree, and the which is the fruit of a tree yielding seed. To you it shall be for meat.
To you it shall be for food. We got to change our mentality, our way of thinking. We don't even think of fruit or vegetables as literal food. Only food we think, chicken, turkey, or oxtails, or what else? Steak, beef burgers, that's food. This is just a, you know what we call it? This is a side.
Yeah, you hit it right on the head. Listen, when we, you know this class cut me, y'all, but hey, listen, you gotta learn.
No, this is for us to learn. Change.
When it says superfoods, y'all, superfoods means it's your main food.
Yeah.
Even when the scripture, when we brought out in Genesis, Cap brought out all praises. Let you know those herbs were our main food. Mm-hmm. The meats later on, that was our actual side food.
Yeah.
That was our side dishes.
Yep.
But our main food was the herbs, y'all.
Oh, praises. Let's go back to Sirach. Let's read verse where we leave off at. 19. Yep, let's read that.
Sirach chapter 31, verse 19. A very little is sufficient for a man well nurtured. And he fetcheth not his wind short upon his bed.
Now, we all done been through that. We, you wives, you husbands, you know what that scripture's going. You can attest. You can testify. You can give a testimony on that. We all know that. Now, jump up to verse 28.
Verse 28.
Is that what I wanted? Yeah.
Wine measurably drunk.
No. Sirach 37 and 27.
Sirach chapter 37, verse 27.
Yep.
My son, prove thy soul in thy life and see what is evil for it.
Now, that script meditating on the context of which we're talking. Prove thy, what does it say? My son, prove thy soul in thy life and see what is evil for it. That goes back to that communion upon thy bed. You know, think about it. In right now in your life, with your health and your diet, is there some things that you should be taking out of your diet because you know it's not beneficial for you at this moment in your life? Maybe once you get yourself back together through the food of God, the vegetables and the fruits and stuff like that, you can go back to introducing some of that into your diet. But right now, asking yourself, is there some things that you can take out of your diet right now to improve your health? You got to think about that. Read that again, verse 27.
My son, prove thy soul in thy life and see what is evil for it and give not that unto it. For all things are not profitable for all men. Neither have every soul pleasure in everything.
Now, what I got written here, when it comes to that, some of y'all got to think because some of us need to seriously change our diet. Seriously change our diet. Like, you know, we've been in the hospital for high blood pressure, or we've had to go to the hospital because our chest was hurting. Why is that? It's a number of factors. One of the main reasons could be the diet that we have been putting in our body on a daily basis is slowly creeping up and catching up with us. And the Lord had mercy on us to warn us with a little bit of a health scare for you to get checked to be like, okay, it's time to change. So some of us need to prove ourselves and don't give ourselves certain things to eat because we in more drastic situations than other people. Read on.
Be not insatiable in any dainty thing, nor too greedy upon meats.
So although we are able to eat meats, listen to what the Lord says. Now, a lot of people be fighting tooth and nail about when it comes to eating meat and all of that. Oh, you pushing that on her. The Lord says, don't be too greedy upon meats. Don't be insatiable with it. Like we've seen in the video, it said half your plate ought to be the fruits of the vegetables. The Lord is backing that up with don't be too greedy upon the meats. Read on.
For excess of meats bringeth sickness and sobriety. And subverting will turn into cold.
That's another way of saying being insatiable, overeating. So this is thus saith the Lord. A lot of us, a lot of times we skip over that stuff. We be skipping right over that. Don't be too greedy upon meats and the excess of meat bring of sickness. Whenever we get sick, we don't never want to test it back to the way we eating or the meats that we've been putting in our body. We don't never think about that. But the Lord's saying the excess of meat is a reason why a lot of us are sick. A lot of our people are sick and got underlying health conditions. And just think about this. You putting in the worst type of meats. Our people put the worst type of meats in their body to bring your health down. The worst type. Now read verse 31.
By subverting have many perished, but he that taketh heed prolongeth his life.
And I pray all of us listening to this class, we take heed to the scriptures that have been coming out, the videos, the articles that we have been going. I pray all of us take heed to this. So we can, before our time is called, comes before the Lord, we can live a healthy life during this time while we're here. Go to that 8th article. Let's get some solutions to this stuff. See what the doctors or the scientists say. So I pray we take heed. Read that. It's the high blood pressure in African Americans.
High blood pressure in African Americans.
Go down to treating high blood pressure.
Treating high blood pressure in African Americans. If you have high blood pressure, consult your doctor to find which combination of treatments work best. Given your individual health and lifestyle, your treatment plan is likely to include the following elements.
Now listen to this. It says your treatment is going to these following elements. Look what the first one on the list is to bring down the high blood pressure that majority of black people in America, the highest in the world, has. What's the first one?
Follow the DASH eating plan, the dietary approaches to stop hypertension.
The dietary approaches. We've become so dependent on pills to monitor our high blood pressure. But God says that if you eat what I tell you to, eat the fruit in your captivity, it can bring down the blood pressure where we don't have to be so dependent on the pills. Now, like I said, I'm not a doctor. I'm not telling you to. Oh, I am. That was a word from God. Throw the high blood pressure pills out the window. Not telling you to do that at all. Moderation. It's a balance. Eat those fruits to bring that thing down, and you can wean yourself off of that. Go ahead, Cap.
Right. So like Cap was bringing out, in order for these herbs to actually work, or the fruits, the vegetables, to actually work in your body, remember, your body has to get accustomed to it. Yeah. It's already got all that junk food, McDonald's, Burger King already in it. Don't expect in a couple of days you eating a salad and eating fruits, it's going to work overnight. It takes time, y'all. Your body has to get accustomed to it, begin to grasp it, put it through your bloodstream. Remember a video we always watch, G-bombs, right? If you don't see it in your waist, you don't see your poop green, just know that means your body is not taking it. So it takes time for the actual fruits, vegetables, and healing process to take place.
Yeah, so that could be 6 months. It could be a year. It could be 2 years before you start seeing change. But every day, remember, you're trying to overturn 20 years of bad eating habits. It's going to take time, but it will. It'll work, thus saith the Lord. It'll work. You see where Daniel went? It 10 days. You can see the change in him physically, right? So much more with us. We start to apply these different eating habits. You can see the change internally in us over a process of time. Let's go back to the article. Go back to that article. Read through that real quick.
DASH diet plan includes eating less fat and saturated fat.
Now, I looked this up, saturated fat, and I didn't know because, look, we don't know this stuff. I know none of us know what saturated fat means. I looked it up. Saturated fat means it's milk, cheese, meat. What else he got here? Tropical oils, including coconut and palm oil. Now, I've been told coconut oil is fatty in the, and I know a lot of us cook with that. So it says health organizations say cook with vegetable oil, such as canola oil, to decrease heart disease risk. That's what the experts say with that. So saturated fat goes into milk, cheese, meat, and oil, and certain type of oils. That's what saturated fat is. And I know that's a major part of a lot of our diet as a people, of what we use to satisfy our flesh and to make things taste better. So we got to be conscious of that. Eating less fat and saturated fat. Read on as well.
As well as eating more fresh fruits and vegetables and whole grain
food. We keep seeing that thing over and over again. We got to start taking heed to that as a nation, people. We got to take heed to what is being said. Because it ain't like you getting this knowledge from Esau and the white man of the nations. This stuff is first implanted in what? Our book. We just got to open our spiritual eyes to see how our forefathers ate. When you pay attention to it, man, fruits and vineyards and vegetables and gardens is so much through the Bible. It's crazy. We just overlook it because we ain't really focused on it pertaining to our health. But these are the times that we need to. Because remember, there ain't no cure for the virus that's been killing black people at astronomical rates right now in this short amount of time. So we got to do this preventive medicine, and this is it right here. Go back to it.
Yeah. Limiting alcohol consumption can also help lower your blood pressure.
That's why God says, be not a drunkard, be sober. Go ahead.
A dietitian can help you find ways to meet these goals without giving up your favorite food.
Read the next one.
Limit salt intake.
Do what?
Limit salt intake.
Oh, you know we love it. You know we love some salt to sprinkle it on there. And there's also, you know, it's for the unrepentant brother and sister, that pork chops and that pig, that swine that our people love is high in salt content. That's why half your grandmas got gout and big ankles. Some of them ain't got no feet no more. Or they missing a toe. That's the truth. Read that.
Limit salt intake because blacks seem more sensitive to salt.
I wonder why God made us more sensitive to salt. I wonder why. Read on.
It makes sense to watch how much salt you eat. Table salt and sodium used in processed foods are the two sources of sodium in your diet.
Now we understand that sodium and most of our food is processed. It's in everything. So what we have to do, be conscious of the intake of it. You got to be conscious of it. And especially, remember, prove yourself. Where you at in your health, in your life right now at this moment, you might have to cut that stuff out your diet altogether. And you know what is a natural sweetener? Honey. Honey's a natural sweetener, so find some foods that go good with honey and not particularly foods that go good with salt and change your diet for the better. Go ahead.
Consult a dietitian.
All right, jump to the next one.
Watch your weight.
Jump to the next one.
Quit smoking tobacco.
Yep, quit smoking. Quit smoking. And the last one you see is medication, right? Medication being prescribed. Go to the ninth article, African-Americans and heart disease. African Americans and heart disease. I want you to read the first section. Read the first section.
African Americans and heart disease, stroke.
Now, zoom in on it some. Now, I know a lot of us got family members that done had a stroke, borderline stroke, minor stroke, stroke scare in our families. A lot of us, it might not be immediate family, it might be a cousin. Auntie, somewhere we know somebody that might have came across, and that comes from high salt intake and bad health. Go to it. Let's read that.
Heart disease is the number one killer for all Americans, and stroke is also a leading cause of death. As frightening as those statistics are, the risk of getting those diseases are even higher for African Americans.
We've got to be conscious of our diet. We have to be as a people. Go ahead.
The good news is African Americans can improve their odds of preventing and beating these diseases by understanding the risks and taking simple steps to address them. Get checked. Then work with your medical professional on your specific risk factors and the things that you need to do to take care of your personal health. And
scroll down to the next paragraph. Yep, read that.
High blood pressure, obesity, and diabetes are the most common conditions that increase the risk of heart disease and stroke.
High blood pressure, obesity, and diabetes, which plague the Black and Hispanic community. Go ahead.
Here's how they affect African Americans.
Read
some tips.
Read quick.
High blood pressure. The prevalence of high blood pressure in African Americans is the highest in the world.
In the what?
In the world.
In the world, y'all. Go ahead.
Also known as hypertension. High blood pressure increases your risk of heart disease and stroke.
Heart disease just means heart attack. Go ahead.
And it can cause permanent damage to the heart before you even notice any symptoms. That's why it is often referred to as the silent killer.
Yep, high blood pressure is the silent killer. So read that.
Not only is HBP more severe in blacks than whites, but it is also develops earlier in life.
Why you think it develops earlier in life? Because we feeding our kids the same thing that we grew up off of, and they in turn feed their kids the same thing. And we all of that is passed down the line from slavery. Read the next part.
Research suggests
Scroll up, y'all. Come on, pay attention back here.
Research suggests African Americans may carry a gene that makes them more salt sensitive.
Sheesh. Hell, we don't know nothing about science. We can't say that. Well, I mean, but we do see when we eat that stuff, it is a quick judgment from God. We start eating that stuff, high blood pressure goes straight through the roof. Go ahead.
Increasing the risk of high blood pressure. Your healthcare provider can help you find the right medication, and lifestyle changes can also have a big impact.
Now let's read the solutions. Go ahead.
You can't do anything about your family history, but you can control your blood pressure. If you know your blood pressure is high, keeping track of changes is important. Check it regularly and notify your doctor of changes in case treatment needs to be adjusted.
Now jump down to that number one thing.
The number one thing you can do is check your blood pressure regularly.
So check it. If you got high blood pressure, continually check it. Go ahead. Next one.
Obesity. African Americans are disproportionately affected by obesity among non-Hispanic blacks aged 20 and older. 63% of men and 77% of women are overweight or obese.
That we have ate ourselves. We have ate ourselves to death. That's what that means. We have literally ate ourselves to death. Read.
If you're carrying extra weight, Dr. Gandhi suggests, focus on the quality of your diet throughout the day.
Focus on your diet throughout the day. Read on.
Not just during mealtime. You can add hundreds of calories to your diet just on snacking, he said. Choosing wise snacks can be part of a healthy diet.
Wise snacks is what? Fruit. That wise snacks can be fruits. Jump down to that last part. Make what?
Make vegetables the main part of the meal and fill up with those rather than other food.
Now, look at this. We are getting, first and foremost, we are getting the scriptures that are telling us how we could change things. And we got health professionals. If you can't see the signs of the times, you are blinded. Over and over, we keep reading the same thing that help our health as a people. And we can't act like that this don't pertain to us because a lot of us got it right now in the truth. Okay, we might go over murder one day. It's okay, that I'm not really like that. Oh, I might go over stealing. Nope, I'm not like that. Fornication, adultery. Oh, no, really. I listen to be warned, but I really don't battle with that. All of us fall into this category of health because it could take one depressing day, one depressing day, and you eating those, what we call those, food trap foods, and it could start you down a path of destruction. Go back to it. So it says make vegetables the main part. Read the next part.
If you're thirsty, drink water, not juice.
Oh, if you're thirsty, drink water, not juice. Woo, I'm still working on that myself. Get some taste of the lemon water or something, man. Change it up. I'm working on that. Yep. You know how you do it with the kids? Hey, you know you want to wean yourself off the juice? Make some juice water. Mama, can I have some juice? Are y'all paying attention back here? Come on, stay attention to the class, y'all. Give me some juice water. Get yourself some juice water as an adult. It ain't nothing wrong with that. There ain't no law that says thou shalt not drink juice water. All right? You can wean yourself off of that. Drink some juice water.
Tobias don't know what juice water is. Bro, you put like 2 little drops of juice. The rest of the cup is water.
Nah, I need a little bit more than that. You ain't going to fool me. I need like 1/4 juice and about 3/4 water. We're good.
Hey, you know how they fool yourself, Cat? Don't get the clear cups, like the glass cup. Uh-huh. Put the color cups. And that's how I guess.
Nah. My taste buds is too advanced to fool me.
I know, Judah, you got to smell the sugar in the cup.
Yeah, Judah,
if you don't smell the sugar in the cup, forget about it.
Woo! Shame on you, Cap. Shame on you for pointing that fact out. Let's go back to that article.
Diabetes. African Americans are more likely to have diabetes than non-Hispanic whites. Diabetes is treatable and preventable, but many people don't recognize early warning signs. Or they avoid seeking treatment out of fear of complications.
Go ahead.
Dr. Gandhi said many people associate the disease with older relatives who were diagnosed too late or had poorly controlled diabetes and suffered preventable complications such as blindness, amputations, or renal failure.
Hey, that's real talk right there. People associate disease. Go back to it. Let me read that real quick. Older relatives who were diagnosed too late. Or had badly controlled, and we know, we've seen it. Well, hell, Big Mama and Soul Food got a foot cut off. Am I right? Yeah. Big Mama. Soul Food, eating it all her life, diagnosed too late, got her foot cut off. And she ended up dying. woo! Go back to the article.
For diabetes and other heart disease risks, regular exercise also plays a key role.
All right, there we go. Exercise. Let's go. Read it.
Both in strengthening and cardiovascular system and burning extra calories. Aim for at least 30 minutes of walking a day.
So now look at this. I was thinking of ways of how can we apply this in the truth. You know what we could do? We could get out and walk. We could call a sister or call a brother, go walk. Or if you happen to walk by yourself, nobody's around, you know, you're busy during the week, that's a perfect time to go walk in 30 minutes. Turn on that Bible app. Oh, that's a perfect time to do that. Perfect time. Get that 4, 5, 10, 15 chapters in that 30-minute walk. That's a perfect time to apply scriptures and getting that health together at the same time. Go to Sirach chapter 30. So take heed to those things that can improve those. If you find yourself overweight, you find yourself high blood pressure, you find yourself with diabetes, those are some things that can bring those things down. Take heed. The scriptures say, do what? Take heed to the physician. That's what we just read. Take heed to the physicians, y'all. Read that in Sirach chapter 30, 14 through 16.
Sirach chapter 30 and verse 14.
Verse 14, yep.
Better is the poor, being sound and strong of constitution, than a rich man that is afflicted in his body.
So we might not have that much money in this captivity. We might be living check to check. We might be waiting on Trump's check to get us by. But at the but one thing that even in our state we could be proud of if we get to that point is better it is to be sound of body and have a good constitution, a right mind, than to be in bad health and have the money. Living it up. Keep it up with the Joneses, but we got terrible shape. It's better to have a little bit, but have a good and sound, healthy body. Read on.
Health and good estate of body are above all gold, and a strong body above infinite wealth.
Uh-huh.
There is no riches above a sound body, and no joy above the joy of the heart.
So understanding that health is important in our life, health is important in maintaining the temple of God that he has given to us in our days here on the earth that we have up under the sun. Let's change the way we think about food. Let's get our diet and our health better so we can enjoy the time that's been given and we can praise the Lord during that time with all our strength. The better health that we in, the harder we can praise the Lord.
We used to scream black power while Heron was pushed. But at the end of the day, nothing's in vain. IUIC has been given a vision. The tents of Judah has risen. Many has attempted the mission, minor murmuring, omitting, and missing the mark. Just reading that he had the flame of fire in his eyes gave us the spark. We on Paul's mission. We out on the road, purple and gold, from Mexico, Cuba, Haiti, Ghana, Sierra Leone. 144,000 boots banging, concrete crackling. These are how our men repented at heart. The scriptures is proof. IUIC, we deliver the truth.